11. Amen. We don't have to labor heavy because you have one of God's best as your pastor. Amen. And so we come tonight just to partner in praise and celebrate the goodness of our God and grateful for the extended opportunity tonight. John chapter 11, starting at verse number 1, we have this passage of scripture nestled here. When you have it, say, I got it. If you don't have it, say, hold up. If you don't know where to look, I think Bible study and Sunday school would do you good. Hallelujah. The King James Version of the Bible simply reads on this wise, now a certain man was sick, are we there together? Named Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. It was that Mary, somebody shout that Mary, which anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore his sister sent unto him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom thou lovest is sick. When Jesus heard that, he said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory. Somebody should have shouted right there. For the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. Then the verse says, now Jesus loved Martha and her sister Lazarus. And when he had heard, therefore, that he was sick, he abode 2 days still in the same place where he was. Go down to verse 11, if you will. These things said he, and after he had said unto them, our friend Lazarus sleepeth, but I go that I may awake him out of his sleep. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We'd like to tag this text for the moments that we have. What to do in times like these? Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, oh neighbor, the preacher's going to preach about what to do in times like these. Amen. My brothers and sisters, by way of introduction tonight, I'd like to share with you that time and time again, we as human creatures are thrust, if you will, into having to deal with our share of problems. If I had a fair church tonight, you'd be honest to say that the plight and the position in which we are now living in is very perplexing. I mean, I don't know how you stand politically, but somehow or another, 45 got some stuff really messed up. I mean, we are asking ourselves right and left, what are we going to do now in times like these? I mean, what do we do when you got children that are fighting against parents and parents that are neglecting children? What do we do in times like these? What do we do when there, every time you turn around, that bad booger that I call cancer seems to invade family lives and disrupt so many different things that we're trying to accomplish? What do you do in times like these? What do you do when you're trying to make sure that all things are lined up, and when you line everything up, somehow or another something comes and knocks everything down? Is there anybody going to be fair in Cherry Grove tonight to say that you've tried your best to do everything you needed to do, everything you were supposed to do, and it seemed like still things didn't work out? You already had your life planned that I was going to get married. I was going to live in a nice white house with a picket fence, 2.1 children. I wish I had a fair church in the air. You knew that you were going to college. You knew that you were going to graduate. You already knew the boo thing that you was going to marry. But somehow or another, it didn't work out that way. You grew up, come on somebody, had a baby out of wedlock, come on somebody, had the boo thing to walk out on you with your best friend. I'm going to come on where you at since you acting like I'm not preaching. The reality of it is you can have your life all lined up, all set up, all prepared, all in line, all dutied up, and in times like these, some things can still go awry. I wish I had a sanctified witness that got your mind made up that it does not matter, come hell or high water, as long as I got King Jesus. As long as I know that I can trust in God, as long as I know I have a relationship with the Master will show up on my behalf. I know I ain't done everything right all the time. I know things are not always going to work out
in my favor, but sometimes I gotta know it's gonna still be for my good. Sometimes God has to take me down to bring me up. It was not on the, I feel like preaching a little bit up in here. It's not on the mountaintop that I learned the most, but it was when I had to go down through sorrow's valley. It's when I had to go through the pause and the parenthetic to pause and wait on God to show me the way. So what do you do in times like these? What do you do when it seems like your valley experience is longer than you had planned on? Do I got anybody in here saying, Lord, how long? Yeah, you said, I know you prayed your prayer and you heard even Donnie McClurkin simply say, all you got to do is stand. But baby, I've been standing and it seemed like I'm standing by myself. The more I anchor myself down, I keep catching hell on the right, hell on the left, hell in front, hell behind me, hell over me and hell under me. Is there anybody, every time you turn around, you're supposed to be getting up. I said, supposed to be getting a blessing. But it seemed like you got more burdens. So the question is, I like this kind of church. What do you do in times like these? Right here nestled in the text is a couple of things that I want to lift and we can get on down the road and go on back to the house and get our sleep on. Is there anybody in here interested? What do you do in times like these when it seems like, Dr. Walker, when you got more family problems than you're able to engage in family praise? We love to rejoice. We love, yes, to celebrate. We love to gather together. But if I had some fair folks tonight, to be honest, most of your problems came when you had to deal with your own family. Don't nobody want to be honest with me. I didn't come from around here, but let me drop this. I think the same thing happened down here that happened to me up north, born and raised in Gary, Indiana. But some of my biggest problems, it was hanging with family folk. I got the drunkest hanging with my family. I got the highest, I ain't got nobody here, hanging with my family. I almost went to jail hanging with my, ain't nobody gonna be honest with you. Oh, that's right, because you sitting next to your family now, so I ain't gonna talk about that. But if I had some honest folk, you tried to be the right one, but it seemed like the wrong thing happening because you were around some folk. Keep looking at me, don't worry about what they looking at. But I've come to help you understand that even in the family structure, even when trouble comes, even when trials and tribulation press you, what do you do in times like these? The text is tailored to teach us that even in the family, there's a prescription on what to do. Here it is. We know the text got this family. Mary, Martha, and their brother Lazarus. The Bible says here that Jesus befriended them. God, let me park here and help you understand one thing. The good thing about all things that happen is that you gotta have a friend like Jesus. That what do I do in times like these? I gotta make sure I got a friend like Jesus. There is no other name upon the earth where we can call upon that men might be saved except for the name of Jesus. How do you figure that out, Philip? In the text it said every time Jesus happened to go through the town of Bethany, he stayed at Mary, Martha, and Lazarus's house. If I had somebody to be honest with me tonight, you testify, everybody just can't stay at my house. Are y'all gonna talk back to me? I mean, I let me keep the focus on myself and how I raised, because I don't know you like that, but I got some family folks that when they come, I start putting stuff up. Somehow or another, they got magnetic fingers. Come on, somebody. They happen to pick up stuff that don't necessarily belong to them, and stuff that didn't have legs when they came got legs when they left. So everybody can't just stay at my house. But Jesus was a friend to them. And here it is, that friendship caused them to have a relationship with him. And so when Lazarus gets sick, the first thing they did was call on their friend. I wish I had the right house here. And you ought to be able to depend on your friends in your time of need. But the dangerous thing is, most of us have friends that we've hand selected, and those friends become friends and they eventually become foes, especially when it comes with your finances. I'm getting happy all by my sanctified self. The reality of it is, this friendship was so close and so close-knit that Jesus stayed with them. And when Lazarus got sick, they sent for him. They sent for him. They sent for him. They sent for him. They sent for their friend in times like these. So what do I do, Pastor Philip? In times like these, when you find yourself with your back up against the wall, when your money gets funny, your change gets strained, when you're sick, when you're down, when you're out, you ought to be able to see in for Jesus. That's the prescription right there. In times like these, you got to know how to send for Jesus. And the only way you can send for Jesus is when you've been in a relationship with him. Not having good religion. Good religion will get you to the door, but a relationship will get you in the kingdom. I wish I had a witness in here that could testify. You're glad that you have a relationship with him, and in times like these, you can call on him. They all, the text says, leads us to believe that they all had a relationship with Jesus. Now, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. And because Jesus loved them, and because their love for him, they realized that when trouble comes in times like these, you gotta send for Jesus. And so the Bible says he was sick unto death. Now, if it were ever a time or a time that you needed somebody, is when you sent word before it got too bad. He was sick, y'all. They sent for Jesus. But Jesus didn't get there in time. Anybody ever been there? You called on the Lord. You prayed and you cried. And he still didn't show up in time. Yeah, you sang the song, he may not come when you want him, but he'll show up right on time. But how about, what do you do when his time is not your time? Yeah, you prayed, Lord, help me pay these bills before I get evicted out of my house. And you get evicted anyway. Lord, show up before they repo my car and they come get it anyway. Show up for Big Mama die and she lie anyway. Lord, show up in my household before my children start acting crazy and they go ahead and act crazy anyhow. I stop by to find out, what do you do in times like these? You gotta send for Jesus, but then you gotta trust in what he says. The Bible said, he told him, he said, this sickness, y'all done let a fat boy get happy, this sickness is what not unto death. And so therefore, when you have a relationship with him and you send for him and he tell you it's not as bad as you think, you gotta trust him. You gotta hold fast. You gotta believe the word, and the word got power. Lord, how can you say it's not unto death and you ain't here? He said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory. I wish I had a sanctified witness. Yeah, here I am. Oh, yeah, without one plea. He wants to know, can you stand when times like these? Are you willing to trust him and lean not to thine own understanding, but in all thy ways, I think I see an exit here, acknowledge him and he'll direct your path. Is there anybody in Cherry Grove that made up in your mind that it does not matter how long it takes, I'm going to wait on him. I'm trusting in him. I'm leaning and depending on his holy word. It does not matter how long, Lord. I trust in you. If you said it, that settles it. I wish I had about 13 witnesses in Cherry Grove that didn't mind giving your neighbor a high five and say, I trust his word. I got faith to believe that if he said it, he'll bring it to pass. Is there anybody? I'm gone now. Gonna trust in God? No matter how long it takes, the Bible says, that he said, this sickness is not unto death, but unto the glory. Yes, the glory of God. I'm gone, Cherry Grove, but what do you do in time like these? You gotta have a relationship with Jesus. Not only just have it, but you also gotta know how and what to do when trouble comes. You gotta know how to send for Jesus. Tell your neighbor, sin, sin for Jesus. Tell him all about your troubles. And when you talk to him, you gotta have faith and trust in his word. Is there anybody here had to wait on God? He may not come when you want him to come, but he'll show up on time, even when his time is not your time. I wish I had a witness that didn't mind testifying. I'm gonna wait on him. That's the last thing I got for you. You gotta wait on him. The Bible says that he abode two more days before he got there to see about their request. Good evening, y'all, and God bless your heart. They was worried, they were fretting, they were frustrating, and he waited. I wish I had a witness here. He waited two more days. They were mad about it. They were frustrated about it, because their culture said if he'd have got there by the third day, he would have been able to recover them. But he waited until the fourth day, where he was buried, stinking and buried. Can I get a witness here? He said, when he died, I let him die so that I can get some glory. Good evening, Cherry Grove. He's allowing some trouble to come so he can get some glory. Is there anybody got a made up mind that you're gonna let God get some glory? Don't sit here looking at me. He picked you out so he can get some glory, but you gotta wait on him. You gotta trust in him. He's on the way. Even though you're waiting, you gotta know he's working on your behalf. I know he's all right. I know he will. I tried the man, and the man's all right. Is there anybody in this room tonight gonna wait on him? May have to cry, but you're gonna wait on him. May be down, but you're gonna wait on him. Have to deal with some unpleasantries, but you're gonna wait on him. I need a sanctified witness and a worshiping warrior that don't mind saying, here am I, Lord, I'm gonna wait on you. I know it get hard, I know it get rough, I know it's down, but all to be kept by Jesus. I done got too happy here. When he got to them, there had to be some of our cousins, some of our relatives, because they met him at the road with an attitude and saying, Jesus, if you would have been here. Anybody know what I'm talking about? If you had a been here, somebody say, that's my cousin. If you had a been here, my brother wouldn't have died. He said, I was already there, and I let him die. He said, show me where you laid him. Show me where you laid him. Show me where you laid him. And they took him to the rock where he was. And Jesus spoke to Lazarus and said, Lazarus, hey, Lazarus, come. come forth. And that's all I want to tell you, Cherry Grove. It's your season. It's your time to come forth. If you wait on him, if you trust in him, you can listen your ear to the voice of Jesus when he said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. I'm out of here, y'all. Well, where's your exit, Phillips? One Friday! Thought I was at the right Baptist church. One Friday! One Friday! On a hill called Calvary. Anybody know what happened? He died. Do y'all know he died? But that's not how the story ends. Three days later, he got up with all power was in his hands. I'm going to wait on him. Are you going to wait on him? Are you going to be faithful? Are you going to trust him? Won't he do it? I'm out of here, y'all. I said, won't he do it? Won't he make a way out of no way? Won't he dry your tears? Won't he put running in your feet? Clapping in your hand? Joy! Yes! Joy in your heart! Ah, what do you do in time like these? Wait on him. Trust in what he says. And tell your neighbor one more thing. Say, praise him until he goes up. Praise him until he open up the door. Praise him until he make a way. Praise him until you get your deliverance. Praise him till he bring you out. This joy I have. The world didn't give it to me, and the world can't take it away. I done got happy here now, but can I ask you one question, and I'm going to leave you alone? Can I ask y'all a question, and I'm going to leave you alone? Can I ask this church just one question, and I'm going to leave you alone? Ain't he good? Say yeah. I know he's all right. I know he's all right. I done got a Sunday morning feeling on a Wednesday night. I know he's all right. No, he's all right. I know he's all right. Will you praise him? I said, will you praise him till you get your healing? Will you praise him till you get your breakthrough? Will you praise him till the blessings begin to shower down? Drip, drop, drip, drop, drip, drop, drip. Let some rain, showers of blessings fall on me. What do you do? Times like these. You gotta have a relationship with him. Can't make it without a relationship with him. And with that relationship, you got to know how to sin for Jesus. And when you sin for Jesus, you got to trust and have faith in what he said. He said, this one is not unto death. Can I speak in this house? Y'all got me out here bad now. Can I speak in this house? The next one might kill you, but this one won't. Hey! Yes, sir, Lord. He said, this sickness is not unto death. I don't know what tomorrow gonna be, but this one right here, baby, it's development and not denial. Y'all to let a fat boy get happy here. See, the enemy wants you to think that in times like these, this one that you're facing, this one that you're dealing with, is the one to terminate you. But it's not the one that terminates you, it's the one that determines me. I'm out here bad, Walker. See, because the reality of it is, you've been through stuff before. Anybody gonna testify you've been through some stuff before? Lay hands on yourself and say, I'm on the other side now. And if he's the same yesterday, oh, today, he'll be the same in the morning. And if he, whoa, if he did it before, come on, talk back to your boy. He'll do it again. So you need to tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, this one right here ain't the one gonna win. I know that's Ebonics. Ain't the one gonna win. This one will not win over you. You need to tell your neighbor, say, I got that. That one, that right there was for me. That one. I know you came for just another experience, another church service, but this worship right here was for you. It's okay. You crying. But can I help you? Walker, I'm trying to lead this thing along. But the reality of it is, while you're waiting on him to show up, don't think he ain't working.
Wow.
They had buried him. He had died. They had buried him, right? He was already in the grave. And Jesus says to the disciple, let us go. He was on the way, but he was already dead. I ain't got nobody gonna help, Reverend. Just like the hands on the clock, you see the big hand moving, other hand moving a little bit faster. But the reality of it is, you don't see all the work that's going on behind to make those hands move. See, stop thinking that everything that's working is working against you. That's for the third person. Bro, man, that's for the third person. Because you're thinking everything that's happening is satanically attached to help, to hurt you and to hinder you. But the reality of it is, it's some stuff that God is allowing to happen so that it can make you better. Because everything that happens, I'm out of here, I'm dropping the mic. Everything that happens is either God allowed or God arranged. Everything. Is he not a sovereign God? Is he not an omniscient God? Is he not an omnipresent God? Come on, somebody. So there's nothing that happens that's a surprise to God. So he either stepped back to allow it to happen, or like Job, he stepped back to allow it to happen, or some stuff he arranged to happen. Can I get a witness? This man was born blind. Question was, who did sin, this man or his parents, that he was born like this?
And he said that the works of God may be made manifest. So God arranged for the man to be born blind because he wanted to get some glory. Some stuff he allowed and arranged for happen in your life simply so what? He can get some glory.
Lord have mercy.